Okay, good evening. I hope all of you are there. We are going to see or we are going to listen to the last presentation. After this, we will not have two presentations on 10th and 13th. Then we will have the next presentation after these two days. We will have a presentation on the summary of this. You may be wondering why I am doing this. Is the why this type of presentations I am doing and I am addressing to you people. I do not know whether you have got the point. The success or the research will yield the desired result only if we get a good material. The whole of the photoelectrochemical or photocatalytic process, any catalytic process, is only the material. Here the electrochemistry or photocatalytic water decomposition requires a material. Now all these days we have been either following the titanium dioxide and titanium dioxide derived materials, or some semiconductors where we have imposed certain restrictions, like the whether the band gap is suitable for the solar radiation and other things. Now this type of imposed conditions will not lead us to a desired material. Desired material here is that it should give rise to at least Carnot efficiency. So therefore we know very well in the last 4.5 decades we have tried many materials. We means the scientists, okay, tried many materials and still we have not yet reached the Carnot efficiency. In this presentation also we are going to see how we are going to make the materials, but all these things are what is done, okay. What should be done or what can be done will be our last presentation. So now, as I have been repeatedly telling, that we should be questioning all of them. You may be wondering why I am questioning this, okay? Questioning the choice of the material or the criteria that we have evolved for choice of the material. For example, I have been always advocating that one should not look for visible light for photocatalyst. Ultraviolet photocatalyst also is sufficient. So what I feel and what I am thinking is that the selection of the materials should be based upon broad-based criteria, not like this visible light photocatalyst or the band gap must be this, like that. What we, instead of that, we have already presented in one of the presentations that we have talked about the bonding characteristics of the material, okay? And I told you, I have outlined that it should have ionicity of the cation anion must be around 30 to 40%. It should not be too highly ionic or too highly covalent, like graphitic materials. It is not only this, we have also brought out another condition, that the surface that we are producing must be equipotential. Why this equipotential and how this equipotential surfaces can be obtained, we will come to it later on. The necessity for the equipotential site is that the charge carriers that we have generated by the photon absorption has to migrate to the surface, and the surface, the solid surface liquid interface, should be capable of accepting the electrons within the lifetime of the exciton. We will come to it. The lifetime of the exciton, we have already told, the time taken for creating an exciton is of the order of picosecond or femtosecond, and the charge transfer is of the order of nanosecond. So therefore, there is a order of difference in the utilization of the electrons and holes that we have told. So this, if in the process of the migrating the charges to the surface, if they were to recombine, then it will be simply giving rise to heat, and will be leading to loss of energy in the form of the photons. So now this is the reason why we have been always telling that we have to question everything, even though it is all established and given by very knowledgeable persons. We should not take them on the face value. We should be capable of questioning everything and giving our own suggestions. Now that is the time that we have reached. Now we will have to look at these suggestions in the next presentation. Now, to recap, okay, one is, we have already told that the photons that we are using should be capable of exciting the electron from the valence band to the conduction band. Now, secondly, we have already told that the ionicity of the bond must be such that it should be capable of giving rise to the ionic cation anionic bond. Ionicity must be around 40%. That is the second thing, but this is a very abstract thing. We have to look at it very carefully. Then just now we put another condition, equipotential surface. Now, equipotential surface means, why this equipotential surface is required is, we want to modify the photon absorption. We are going to see this today. Photon absorption wavelength or the energy by suitable modification of the surface. Okay, one of the modifications is what we are going to see today. So, just a minute. Solunga. Lab la irukken, enna vishayam? சரி வாங்க, நான் இன்னொரு 1 hour இருப்பேன். ஆமா, சரி. So now the recap is, we have generated the electron hole pair and how to keep them alive for the reaction and other things which we are going to see. So certain governing principles we have put. Now in this, what I have learned is what I have put here. Now what I have learned so far is that the questions, doubts, and probably some of the misgivings that you have is that we need a basis of electrochemistry for proper understanding of the photoelectrochemical decomposition of water. This means that we have to now revisit the electrode electrolyte interface as it is done in the electrochemistry, and add that to that the photons. So therefore, we have to do this. Maybe it requires about 4 or 5 presentations separately on electrochemistry itself, only to this aspect, to the interface, okay, not to the electrochemistry as a tool or electrochemistry as a subject. Okay, that is a different thing, because that is coming out of that electrodes, ionics, like that. Okay, that is a very, very long 1 semester course. But what we can do is, after this presentation, I will spend 1 or 2 presentations on the structure of the interface as it is in electrochemistry, not photoelectrochemistry, as it is in the electrochemistry, and then the charge transfer in the electrochemistry, then in the photoelectrochemistry, what should be the modifications of the interface has to be done. This modification I have told in a very discrete manner, that the potential Okay, the potential of the valence band and the conduction band is a floating number and not on a static material as we have been doing in a solid state materials. If it is a solid state material, it is okay, but it is a photon also is involved. So therefore, if the photon is involved, the population of the conduction band will be changing, the population of the valence band is in changing, therefore automatically the Fermi level will change, the relative potential of the electron if it is a reducing species or a hole, which if it is an oxidizing species also is a dynamic parameter. What do we mean by this? We have to look at it very carefully. We will look at all these aspects in a separate presentation after the completion of this presentation, the next 14th presentation. But this is possible only if you are all want it or not. I do not know, because I should not be assuming that you need this course. But anyway, if you think you can mail us, we will see whether we can plan such a course in due course. Okay, so now there is another problem that is existing here, as I have already told you, that the how do we carry out these reactions? What type of reactors that we use? Because we have got certain reactors which are already known, okay, slurry reactors, immersion reactor, distribution reactor, external illumination reactor, which is mostly followed, all those things. Therefore, the reactor design is also an important parameter here, okay, because the photons should not get scattered at the surface itself, and there are so many surfaces before the photon reaches the substrate. So therefore, we have to think about a separate presentation on how to design a reactor for this type of studies, which will also be taking care of the determinant of the mass transfer. Okay, so this is another thing that many of you may be having doubt. Many of you may not be working on this, therefore you may not have doubts on this, but those of you who are already working on it, you must think about this. The reactors that we are using have got their own limitations. We should be keeping this in mind. And keeping this in mind, and must be able to rectify or modify our reactors to minimize all these effects. Now I will read this out and then I will explain to you. The growth of heterogeneous photocatalysis has been and will continue to be application driven. Application driven here is, it can be decomposition of water or pollutant removal or organic synthesis or whatever it is, supported by strong process fundamentals. Solar water splitting and environmental remediation, which are the mainstay applications, will continue to serve as important platforms for showcasing for photocatalytic technologies, as well as motivation for establishing relevant fundamental knowledge. In addition, the photocatalytic conversion of carbon dioxide to fuels and other useful chemicals is expected to be a dominant area and contribute new knowledge, be it in reaction mechanisms, materials design, or reactor design. Same thing holds good for dinitrogen reduction. Okay, I have not added that, but it is also possible. Whereas success in pursuing the different areas of photocatalytic applications are highly rewarding, it is critical to remember that establishing fundamental depth in photocatalysis is the shared responsibility of scientists and engineers alike. At the same time, continuous bridging of interdisciplinary knowledge has been identified, at least within this perspective, as one of the most important elements to warrant sustainable growth of the field for many years to come. Because many of us are starting working in this area, we have to survive for our lifetime on some aspect or other of this science. So therefore, we should be able to in the next 20, 30 years, we should be able to generate a useful research area in this project. Now, here I am showing you methyl lead iodide. Okay, we have already talked about it, just to repeat that mutual, that is HOIP, hybrid organic inorganic perovskites. What is it that we are doing? Okay, we should know all, in generally. We will be able to take the individual results and interpret them, but what we are doing. Okay, here I am showing you the UPS spectrum and the inverse photo emission spectrum. I will tell you what is this helium on UPS and inverse photo emission spectroscopy. Now, what is it means is, if you are ejecting out an electron by photon, the technique, we are now talking about the technique, not the semiconductor. What we are probing is the occupied states of the semiconductor. UPS is the occupied, highest occupied orbital, and very near to the highest occupied orbitals are probed by the UPS. In inverse photo emission spectroscopy is inverse of the UPS or XPS. Instead of putting a photon, you put an electron, and then when the electron goes and occupies a level, there will be an emission of radiation. So that emission of radiation will tell you which is the unoccupied state. So this is all the techniques that we have so far is studying the occupied states. Unoccupied states are not being studied by any technique. This is the technique which is studies the unoccupied states. And we should make sure that if it is a semiconductor, the unoccupied state must be very conveniently overlapping with the conduction bandage. That is what is shown here. So all these materials are fulfilling this condition, all these inorganic, hybrid inorganic organic perovskites. But when I take the methyl ammonium lead iodide and substitute with the bromine, or substitute with the bromine and chlorine, all those things, what we are doing is, I hope you are able to see that the Fermi level is altered, okay? Fermi level is altered very well, and also the band gap is also tuned. This is the one way, this is one aspect of this. There is another aspect of tuning the band gap and the things we are going to see today. Okay, this is, we will not take it in at the moment. This is only to show you, we have already shown you that one dimensional and two dimensional materials are better than the three dimensional materials. And therefore, why, that is one of the reasons why we are talking about gamma C3 and 4. Okay, it has to be prepared in a particular manner. We will see later on all of them. Okay, it has to be prepared from melanin. We will see later. So what is the current situation? Okay, the figure on the right hand side was already shown to you, so therefore there is now no anything. What is the thing is, we are here at the photocatalysis, low cost but low efficiency. What we want is high efficiency and low cost. This is what we want. And ultimately, we want some materials which will fall in the red line. We will come to it. But this picture we have already shown. What is the picture here shown on the left hand side is, what is the current situation of all the research that we have done? Okay, the current situation is, we have shown by two brackets. I hope you are able to see two brackets here and here. The bracket at the down has been very well studied. Okay, as I told you, it can be for CO2 fixation or N2 fixation, artificial photosynthesis, photocatalysis, water decomposition, whatever it is. But what is not known, what is remaining is the arrow is going, and final goal is solve energy problem by sunlight. Okay, we have to use sunlight and solve the energy problem completely. That is the aim of this. So therefore, the gap that is available is from here to here, to going from here to here. So now, if I were to take, for example, here we are not looking at the water decomposition, but what we are talking about is what we can do with the exciton, electron and the hole. So now, if I were to take the electron and put it in the from the valence band to the conduction band, I can have a hole created in the energy level in the forbidden gap or in the valence band itself. So now the electron can be transferred to H plus or to the oxygen itself. That is also possible. Then we, when the electron is transferred to the oxygen, then we are getting the O2 minus radical or OH radical. Therefore, the OH radical or O2 minus radical, both of them are capable of oxidizing species. So therefore, they can be used as a potential pollution removal situation. Now, if I were to take the holes, I can also do the same thing with the oxygen. Okay, and the hole in the valence band can be put into the generation of the OH radical. So now there was a question in the, in between sometime, what is the effect of substitution of boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and fluorine? Okay. So you can see here, we have shown here the energy levels, okay, of the substituents that we are now making, okay. So therefore, the energy levels of the boron, energy levels of carbon 2p, boron 2p, carbon 2p, nitrogen 2p, and that of the fluorine, and also fluorine will be more stabilized with respect to the oxide ions. Therefore, it will be below the valence band. But subsequently, we will be having titanium 3 plus, therefore that will give you the thing. So this is all the things that are there. So now you can see that the band gap of the semiconductor is now, if you are going to excite it from here to here, or here to here, or here to here, or from here, from here to here. So therefore, schematic illustration of the localized impurity energy states for the substitutionally doped TiO2 is shown in the figure A. In the figure B, electronic structure of titanium, sulfur, oxygen, nitrogen. Okay. Instead of oxygen, we are putting sulfur or nitrogen, showing the presence of localized impurity energy states. The nitrogen state, nitrogen 2p, pi orbital of NO, and the p orbital of sulfur. Okay, and the valence band levels also will be getting perturbed. Pi star of NO is in the forbidden gap, pi of NO is in the valence band. So the same thing is shown here, but it is in a better manner. We have already seen, if I were to dope with the fluorine, it will be giving rise to energy levels below the valence band. Nitrogen will give you in the forbidden gap. Oxygen vacancy will give you also in the forbidden gap. When I have oxygen vacancy, automatically titanium 3 plus will be there. That will be very near to the conduction band. So therefore, the transitions can be either from the nitrogen to the conduction band, then it can get de-excited and recombined with the nitrogen, or de-excited through titanium 3 plus and recombined with the nitrogen. So therefore, visible light excitation of nitrogen fluorine co-doped titanium dioxide, refilling of the empty nitrogen states by electron transfer from either titanium 3 plus or oxygen vacancy. So we have already shown this, therefore we will not what we have shown here is, instead of using the electron in the hydrogen H plus proton, if I were to use the hydrogen on a reactive oxygen species ROS, then I will be able to produce oxygen O2 minus radical or HO radical. We have already seen that. So now we can also do something else, photo-exciting a metal, okay, plasmonic metal, and then injecting that electron to the conduction band of the titanium dioxide. Okay. But you see, this transfer time is of the order of some femtoseconds, 100, maybe about 250 to 300 femtoseconds. But the radiation is already in the visible region, 550 nanometers. Now here what we are showing is the hole trapping agent or rhodium. If you are using rhodium, then rhodium can be used as an oxidant to convert the volatile organic substance to CO2 or O2 to H2O2 to reduce them. Okay, so therefore here I have not put the exactly the charge, because even though the rhodium 3 plus is substituted into the semiconductor, how it is transferring the electron is a rhodium oxidized species. That is all. Its valence state can need not be 3 plus. Now, just to recall, we have already seen that P25 is the standard substance, which is a mixture of annotase and rutile. What is happening in annotase and rutile? This is one picture. We have already shown to other pictures. So now, if I were to look at the, if I were to excite in the annotase, the electron can be going to the conduction band of the rutile. And the hole can be either reacting with the annotase, or we reacting on the surface of annotase or on the surface of rutile. Okay, it all depends upon whether I am exciting the electron from the valence band to the conduction band, or to the impurity states to the conduction band in both the systems. So electron transfer mechanism of annotase and rutile, heterojunctions in visible light photocatalysis. Okay, all of them are visible light. This is the picture which we have shown already, so we are only taking it for this presentation. This is the density of states of the conduction band and the valence band of a white TiO2. This is the density of states, the A picture. A picture left hand side is the black TiO2. The on the right of A picture is the white TiO2, and we have already discussed all of them. And how does it come? We have shown here on the two-dimensional box diagram that how the energy levels are in between. Therefore, the band gap appears to be, it is not a band gap. It is an excitation energy required to excite an electron to the conduction band, around 2.18 electron volt. A schematic illustration showing cascade of electron transfer in the nano macro hierarchically structured TiO2 upon elimination. The Z scheme, okay, this Z scheme I have talked about. The B is the Z scheme, proposed Z scheme mechanisms of the photosynthesis. I hope you are able to see it is just like a, what it means is the electron transfer is so smooth along the two systems that we take. Photosystem 2 and photosystem 1. So now what we have assimilated so far is what we have to see. To learn the general principles of for a material to be photocatalytically active, so far we have seen, that is all. We are not seen what should be. Okay, must be capable of absorbing photons. The photon absorption cross-section must be high, must be electronically conducting, because the electron has to be transferred from the valence conduction band to the counter electrode. We have to also think what should be the counter electrode and what it should be its role. We will see later on. Crystal structure has to be layered. Layered means the charge carriers are only moving in one dimensions or in two dimensions. Therefore, the recombination may be slow. Low dimensional materials are may be preferred. The electronic energy levels should saddle between the water decomposition reactions. The top of the valence band and bottom of the conduction band should be, bottom of the conduction band should be more negative with respect to hydrogen evolution potential. The top of the valence band must be more positive with respect to the oxygen evolution potential in water. And then we have to also look at the material must be stable under potential and also during elimination. What aspects that are still hazy is the question. Electrode-electrolyte interface, structure, charge transfer under the influence of electric field, under the influence of electric field alone. Okay. What we have learned is the electrical interface is metal solution interface. What we are doing here is semiconductor solution interface. Therefore, it has to be very different. Then we have to also look at the photon field combination of electrical and photon field. This is what we have to think. How does electrical field affect the species in the electrolyte? Okay. For example, what I mean by that is I apply a potential on the electrode. Therefore, the potential of the electrons, okay, is altered. If the potential of the electrons are altered in the semiconductor, will it be also affecting the electrons in the electrolyte? That is what you have to see. Okay. How does the photon field affect the species in the electrolyte? Because photons, we are assuming that the photons are absorbed only in the semiconductor. If the photons are also capable of being absorbed in the electrolyte, what does it will happen? Fortunately, water is not absorbing, therefore all our arguments are correct. But it is not the correct if I were to take an electrolyte. How does the combination of these two affect the species in the electrolyte? We are assuming that the electrolyte is stable or same as we have added water. Okay, but we are also adding water and also some amount of electrolyte, sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide or sodium chloride, whatever it is. So that is another thing that we have to understand. Coupling a photon and electric field, is it cumulative or opposing one another? Okay, that is another question we have to answer. So these are the hazy points that we have. So we just looked at the electrolysis water, because electrolysis water means we are only taking the electrical potential effect. We are not taking the photon effect. So now if I were to measure the current, okay, left hand side is the current measurement, up to a particular voltage, there will be a background current alone will be there. Then the total current will be increasing linearly. And out of that, if I were to take the background, subtract the background count, then the red line gives me electrochemical reaction. How the resistance changes is what is shown here, but we will not worry about that. Now, some time back, somebody was asking, how am I estimating the over potential and all those things? Okay, I will compute it in a tricky way. Anyway, it is at a pH zero, the hydrogen evolution potential is zero, the oxygen evolution potential is plus 1.23 volts. Okay, but that is not true. Now, if I were to do the same reaction at pH 14, the hydrogen evolution potential is minus 0.828, and the oxygen evolution reaction is plus 0.41 volts. So the difference is remaining 1.23. But you see, the cathodic process takes place over a belt, and the anodic process takes over a belt. The thickness of the belt, I hope you are able to see, thickness of the belt that we are shown is a measure of the over potential. So therefore, what we are talking about is this 0.4 volts or 0.6 volts for hydrogen evolution and 0.2 to 0.4 volts for 0.4 to 0.6 volts for oxygen evolution and 0.2 to 0.4 for the hydrogen evolution over potential is derived from this type of measurements. We will take it up later on to show that. So now, quickly looking at it, because we are now crossing our time, what we have to see is shown here, electric effects on water. Electric effects means potential effects, okay? Magnetic effects on water. Magnetic effects means you should not think that in the conventional system, the electron arrangement in the solid, how does it affect the water adsorption? Electromagnetic effects on water, water redox process. Okay, all those things I have to do. Now I will read this out and then you can ask me any questions. Although much time has been spent on investigating and modeling electrolytic system, it is still not entirely clear how water is arranged at the surface of the electrodes. I hope you understand this, because we are talking about water adsorption under a potential, not a water adsorption on a surface alone. Water adsorption on a surface, we know very well, gas molecule of water is getting adsorbed, but on the water adsorption at the electrode is different from water adsorption on a surface. Alignment of water dipoles with the field is expected together with the consequential breakage of the proportion of the water molecules or consequential breakage of the hydrogen bonds. When the electrode process occurs, it appears that singly linked hydrogen atoms and singly linked oxygen atoms are bound to the platinum atoms at the cathode and anode respectively. This is in the water electrolysis. That is why you are getting hydrogen and oxygen. But how water is adsorbed on these semiconductors is the question. These bound atoms are able to diffuse around in two dimensions on the surface of their respective electrodes until they take part in the further reaction. This is because the surface is a platinum or any metal, therefore equipotential surface, therefore they are migrating and recombining them. Whereas the oxygen or hydrogen atoms that are adsorbed on the semiconductor, they cannot migrate so easily and recombine. So therefore automatically that appears to be one of the stumbling blocks here. Other atoms and polyatomic groups may also bind similarly to the electrode surface, to the metal electrode surface, clean and subsequently undergo reactions. Molecules such as oxygen and hydrogen produced at the surfaces may enter nanoscopic cavities in the liquid water as gases and become solvated by water. Now, if I have to now combine two hydrogen atoms to evolve hydrogen molecule, or two oxygen atoms to evolve oxygen molecule, I have to bring the solvation also in the picture. Now, how does this solvation in the semiconductors? In the metals, the solvation is there and we can understand that. But what will happen to the, in the case of the semiconductors, how these ions are solvated, and how the solvated ion is capable of solvated H plus, it combines with another H plus to give rise to a hydrogen molecule. This is a very tricky issue. We have to think about all these things. So we will be able to do this in the next presentation. The only one more thing I can show you. All along, we are talking about only water decomposition and 1.23 volts. But there are so many electrochemical reactions that are possible, anode and the cathode. Okay, all the reactions, as far as I know, okay, you can have many more. Here I have taken the electrolyte also. I have told you electrolytes also will do that. Here sodium chloride is taken as the electrolyte, or sodium hydroxide is taken as electrolyte. So therefore, you can see that all these competing reactions are taking place in the solution, and we have to worry about only the 4H plus plus 4 electron giving rise to two H2 molecules. Okay. So therefore, how far all these reactions can be controlled, and how far they can be, the process can be specifically tuned to water decomposition reaction. The same thing is shown here in a pictorial way. So what we have to clarify is the minimum necessary cell voltage to start water electrolysis is 1.23 volts. The potential necessary to start water electrolysis without withdrawing heat from the surrounding is delta H0 by NF, it's 1.48 volts. This is the thermoneutral voltage. Okay, this is the electrochemical potential, this is the thermoneutral voltage. This results in at least 25% unavoidable loss of efficiency. Okay, you have to supply this energy to get this energy. So therefore, not taking into account the over potentials. But normally further heat is generated and efficiency lost from the over potential supplied. So therefore, we have to understand how this thermoneutral potential is applicable to the semiconductors. Thermoneutral potentials are applicable for the metal electrodes, but not for the semiconductors. Then, in addition to that, we have assumed that the over potentials are similar to what is in the metal. Just now we saw that it is not so. The over potentials are going to be because of the solvated proton and solvated oxygen atom will be different in the case of the semiconductors than in the metals. Therefore, the charge transfer can be different, the migration can be different, the diffusion can be different. All these things have to be taken into account. So here I have shown you a thesis given last year, this month, last month, April. Now we are in May. It was approved in April 5th or 6th or something like that in the Gretzel's laboratory, where they have used the alpha Fe2O3. Why I have shown this is one of the alpha Fe2O3 is one of the systems which was originally investigated in the early 70s for the water decomposition reaction. But even now, it is still a question. We'll take it up later. Defects on surface and interface for photoelectrical properties of hematite photoanodes. So now I will stop at this point and answer some questions. Then next 10th and 13th May will be holidays for this online program. So the next will be on 17th Wednesday at the 4 p.m., which will be the last presentation on this topic. Thank you very much. You can ask any questions you want.